Welcome to another episode of Do It Yourself Living and Gardening. And today, the episode is about planting seeds. This is going to be the episode for the general seeds, and the general seeds is pretty much all the seeds that are plant indoors. They're going to go outdoors, except for the peppers, because those have to get started earlier. Now, the first thing you should do when you start is to have a plan. I've got a list here I made on my computer. It has all the seeds I'm going to be planting and how many cells of each seed. Some will be planted in 9-cell trays. Some will be planted in 6 because I don't need that many. And within each cell, I'll probably plant anywhere from 3 to 5 seeds. Depending on what I feel the germination rate is going to be. You always got to hedge your bets a little bit. So, looking at my list, it shows I need 7 of the 6 packs and 18 of the 9 packs. So I've got those out in the sink ready to go. But I also want to show you the trays that I use. These are just your standard tray, but this is just one step up in quality from some of the ones you get at the discount stores, big box stores. I believe I bought this at a hydroponic store. They're a little bit thicker. They're going to hold up a little better, so I prefer them. But even these can have a weak spot, and the weak spot is going to be at one of the corners, the bottom corners. These things get hit, and then before you know it, they crack. So to get around that, I use these little netting trays. I call them netting trays. They use these in the nurseries. They'll put their plants in them and kind of pretend that there's plants in there. Then they have overhead sprayers that'll water these things, and the extra drains out the bottom. And that's why they have holes in the bottom. They'll also use these for carrying plants around. But what I use them for is something entirely different. I take my tray and set it in the inside, and it's a perfect fit. And now if the edge gets hit, it's got this thicker netting tray that protects it. And since I've started doing this, I don't have to buy trays anymore. You can fix those trays by getting some silicone sealer and cramming it in the corners, so you don't have to go out and buy another set. But they're not that expensive, but you know, I try to fix things if I can. So that's what we have. So the next step is we're going to wash the trays. We're going to wash these cells because these are dirty from last year. I do try to remember to hose them off before I pack them up, but you're still going to get some stuff on them, and it needs to come off. And then after they're washed, I'm going to sanitize them in a bleach water solution. The reason why you want to do that is this has bacteria and fungus on it from last year. And if you don't get rid of it, then as soon as your seedlings start to grow, it's going to attack your seedlings. Getting rid of this also will keep down your damping off disease. There's a couple different ways you can try to thwart damping off disease. Some people will put vermiculite over the top after the seeds are in. You can also use a material they use in hydroponics. It's kind of like crushed up recycled glass. You can put that on top. Other people use muffin fans like you would find out of a computer. Matter of fact, I have a muffin fan on 2 of my apple seedlings right now. And that's not to keep the damping off disease at bay. It's to keep them moving and swaying so the trunks get stiff. I still will put a stake in it just to keep it going in the right direction. And but those muffin fans, if you kind of keep it kind of blowing across the surface, will help thwart the damping off disease. Another thing that can help with that is if you're using fluorescent lights, is to keep the lights down low to the point where it kind of keeps the soil a little bit warm. And what that does is it causes evaporation out of the top, so you don't get that layer of dampness that's always there that'll cause the damping off disease to rot the bottom of your plant. So if you're finding that your seedling grows and all of a sudden it kind of rots near the bottom and poof, flops over, you got damping off disease. So you want to take steps, you know, to stop that. So this, like I say, this one of the steps I take is make sure everything is sanitized. Now, I've been using fluorescent lights for years, and that's helped my damping off disease. But this year, I've started to transition over to LEDs. Now with LEDs, I'm not getting that heat coming out of them like I did with the fluorescent tubes. So it remains to be seen how effective that, you know, I'm going to be with keeping the damping out disease at bay. Now I also water from the bottom once the seedling starts. Actually, after I put the seedling in, I don't even water at the top. So most of the watering I do is from the bottom. And as the seedlings progress and get bigger, I kind of create a hybrid system here for watering my seedlings. And it's pretty much called a flood and drain system. But it's not as intricate as a flood and drain hydroponic system, but it's very similar. The difference is I don't keep mine on a timer to come in and cycle, because these are not hydroponically grown seedlings, which means things are going to act differently. Nutrients you use for hydroponics, the pH used for hydroponics is not the same as you do for soil-grown plants, especially seedlings. So it's kind of a hybrid system. And the reason why I kind of designed that little system is it gets a little difficult watering seedlings. And then what happens is, even though I may have three trays, my calculation said I need 2.833 total trays. Well, that means I need three. You round up. Okay? You'll notice as time progresses, I use spreadsheets a lot. I try to do things as scientifically as possible, try to keep order. So my calculations say I need three of these, but that's three when I first start. As these things start to grow, especially tomatoes, they're going to start getting big and crowded. So then I'll take them out of this tray, and then I'll separate these a little bit in a bigger tray. It's quite large. And all that tray is just a washing machine overflow tray without a hole in it, except for when I turn it into a flood and drain system. Then it will have a hole, but it'll have tubes and other things connected to it. And that gives them a little bit more girth to grow, allows light penetration in. And then I'll just come down probably once every 2 days. I'll flip a switch, couple of knobs, it floods. I'll let it sit there and run for a half an hour, make sure the soil's good and absorbed, and then I'll shut the pumps off and then let it drain. And that's my flood and drain way of watering my plants. And it works very good, keeps away the damping disease, keeps them uniformly wet, and is a little bit less hassle for me. Because this is a time of year when I'm so busy, I see myself coming as I'm going, which gets a little crazy. So the next thing we're going to do is I'm going to go over to the sink, and I'm going to wash my cells and my trays. I'm not going to show you that because I think you all kind of can figure out how to wash something like this all by yourself. But I use a sprayer, and you can't really get in there with much of a brush. So I'll just try to get the rough stuff out. Once the bleach water hits it afterwards, it's going to kill pretty much everything that's in there. Then I'll rinse them off. I will be back here, and you'll see I'll have all my cells in the trays. And the next thing we'll do is create the nutrient solution. So to kind of give you a heads up of where we're going with this, I got my notes here. As they say, I keep organized. We'll be washing and sanitizing the cells. I'm going to make the nutrient solution. I do use nutrients in my potting soil. I'm going to make my own potting soil. Then we'll fill the cells with the dampened potting soil, plant the seeds. Then we're going to cover it with clear dome lids, put them on heat mats, and then I'll leave the lights on 24/7 until I get my first set of leaves coming out. The reason why I do that is I want my light to hit these seedlings as soon as those leaves come out of the seed shell. That way it's going to keep them down. You're not going to get leggy. They're going to say, oh, I got enough light right there. I'll just stop growing tall, focus on my roots, and pushing out my first set of true leaves. So with that, I'll see you after I do my washing. We have our cells cleaned, our trays cleaned, and our trays and the protective netting tray. Now, before I began to clean out the trays, I held them up to a light, a very bright light. You kind of hold it up to a light, and then you look through it, and you look for little glimmers of bright light coming through, just to make sure there's no cracks or holes. And I actually did discover a hole in one of my trays, so I had to get another one. So you'll want to do that. And when you clean the cells, I mean, you don't have to go crazy. I'm sure if I look in here, I can find, there it is. See, just a little bit of root. But that's been bleached. So I'm not too concerned with that. Don't drive yourself crazy trying to get these things to look like they're new. It's just not going to happen. Calcium buildup, what have you. But I reuse all my cells. I've been using these cells for, it could be 25 years. And they're, I'd say, a medium grade. You can get some now that are very, very thin, and they just crack so easy. I wouldn't get them. So look for the good stuff, the better stuff. If it's really cheap, the trays, you know, you can buy them as kits. The trays will crack. These things will just rip and tear. But you don't have to go crazy either. I've seen some of these cells go for a lot of money. And they put special slots on them so they'll air prune so they don't circle. I don't go with that. I know I don't have to. And I also don't like the peat pots. Boy, you can spend a fortune on them things. I plant hundreds of plants. If I was to spend money on those peat pots, it's just too much money. And I don't like to waste money. I don't like to spend money when I don't have to. So I would suggest not to get them. Plus, when you plant those peat pots, the roots are supposed to come out, you know, they say naturally and all that. Well, I've used them many years ago, and it didn't work as good as I said. The roots tend to want to stay within that peat pot. They don't like coming out. If you're to pull that plant out, you may see just a little bit of roots coming out. You get them, put these cells, and you pop them out, you plant them in the ground. The soil's right there for the roots. They go out and they get the nutrients they need. So save yourself some money. Don't buy the super expensive equipment, and stay away from the peat pots. Plastic, it's just reuse if you can. If you can't reuse something that's made of plastic, repurpose it. And then as a last resort, recycle it. It's just going to be better off for everybody, the environment, and your plants are going to be fine. Another thing I want to discuss is the size of these cells. The 9 cell packs here, I can have 8 per tray. And these look very small. And there's some people out there that'll tell you, oh, gee, you know, you got to have the big cells. Are the big cells better? Marginally, not enough for me to go out and buy them, though. And the reason for that, it's going to require a lot more potting soil. And then I have to buy more equipment, and these are going to work. And will these get a little bit root bound? Yeah, but it's not going to hurt them, especially if it's a tomato plant. Some people say, oh, you know, if you start them in these things and then you got to graduate them to the next size and the next size and then you go out and plant them. Folks, you don't need to do that. Yeah, these are a little small. You don't want to grow a tomato in here forever and expect to get tomatoes out of it. But that's not the purpose. Purpose is to get these started. These will start them very, very well. And the thing is, the tomato plant's going to get leggy no matter what you do, unless you've got a big, nice greenhouse and you put them in big cells. But then you got a plant that's probably too big to put out there. And I put out a lot of plants. Like, these are 72 cells to a tray. I plant 72 tomato plants. And if I was to put them in, you know, 4x4 squares, where am I going to have the room down in my basement with lights to grow these things out? So over the years, I've learned that I can do it with these small cells. And then once the tomato plant starts to get a little leggy, that's a good thing. And the reason why it's a good thing is because when I plant these tomato plants, and I'll do a section on planting these, you know, take them out of the cells and planting them, all that leggy stem on a tomato plant goes in the ground. And within days, you got massive roots coming out of that stem. So it doesn't matter that these things were root bound in there, because especially for a tomato plant, man, they're going to jump out of, the roots are going to jump out of that stem, and you're going to have massive tomato plants. So don't worry about it. So you make sure you're planting these at the right time. You know, if you plant these in January and you're not going to plant them until the end of May, are you going to have problems? Yeah, you're going to have problems. But your problem was you started too early. You don't want to start too late. You don't want to start too early. You got to figure out, you know, when you're going to be planting. They say start these things 6 to 8 weeks before you're going to go out and plant them. If it's peppers, something that takes a long time to grow out, you want to start them, you know, 2 weeks earlier if you can. Then you're not going to have any problems. I try to get mine out on the front porch as soon as I can, which means that if I'm going to keep them outside in that porch at night, can't go below freezing, you're going to kill your plants. However, I have my onions out right now, and we're, you know, nearing the end of March. We're going to have some freezing nights still, absolutely guaranteed. I'll just carry those into the garage at night. Because my onions, I got to get those things hardened up as quickly as I can, because they're going to go out and be planted before the last frosts are here. Because they're a colder plant, and I'll also be planting some plants out in the garden before the last frost hits. Some of those things will be carrots, peas, I believe kohlrabi, turnips, parsnips. You know, some of these things go out when it's still cool out and the nights will freeze because they can take it. So we're gonna need to move along here. The next thing I gotta do is fill these up with potting soil. Now, like I say, I make my own potting soil. I buy large squares of peat moss. It'll last me 4 to 5 years. I also buy a huge bag of either perlite or vermiculite, whatever I seem to find. And I go 3 parts peat moss to 1 part perlite, or if you're using vermiculite, the 1 part of that. And I mix that up dry, and then I will pour in a nutrient solution, which is nothing more than water mixed with indoor plant fertilizer. Now, I'm not going to say one brand is better than the next, so therefore I'm not ever going to show you the kind that I use, because I'm not advertising for anybody. But I should probably at least tell you what the ratio is of NPK. Let me get that for you. The ratio of the NPK that I use for my indoor plant fertilizer is 20-20-20. But there's going to be some micronutrients in it. And make sure when I buy it, it has the micronutrients. Those are very important. That seems kind of high. So when you're watering your indoor plants with this 20-20-20, and if you're watering your plants once a week, you'll want to use your nutrients every other week. Now for our seed starting, I'll mix a full dose of the nutrients in water, which means if they require a half a teaspoon per gallon, I'll use a half a teaspoon per gallon. Plus, you'll also see that I will use pH down. And in order to figure out how much pH down or pH up that you might use, you're going to need a pH meter. If you don't have a pH meter, just use whatever water you have and don't worry about it. But because I do hydroponics and I do a lot of planting, I know what the pH of my water is coming out of the well, and I know my plants do better if I bring the pH down a little bit. What I'm looking for as pH for soil-grown plants is about 6.5. Now, if I was doing hydroponics, I'm looking at 5.6. And it's kind of easy to remember. You just kind of flip the two digits around. If you're going down to 5.6 for soil, it's too acid. And, you know, if you're running 6.5 in hydroponic, it's not acidic enough. So if you don't want to worry yourself about the pH, that's okay. People have been planting indoor, or planting their seeds indoors for years. I've been watering their plants indoors without any pH adjustments. But just to let you know, if you got city water that's got chlorine in it and fluoride, the pH is going to be around 7 because they adjust the pH right there at the water treatment facility. If you got well water, it could be anything. And it can change from one year to the next. This year, my water's more alkaline than it's been for years. Last year, we had a drought. I think some other veins opened up, blah, blah, blah. So now I got to make sure I put that pH down in there. And I know my plants will do better that way. Now, if I'm watering strictly with water without nutrients, I still adjust the pH. But in this situation, we're going to go, you know, regular strength with the indoor plant fertilizer. I'll use the pH down to adjust my pH, and I don't use a pH meter anymore because I know what it takes to, you know, for the pH down. So I've had that down for, you know, years. And then we're going to use that nutrient solution, and we're going to wet our potting soil that I've mixed, which is the perlite and the peat moss. And that's going to allow my seeds to jump right up as soon as the roots start growing. It's not going to burn them, but once they start growing, I'll bottom water them with regular pH adjusted water. The first time or two, I'll keep an eye on them. If I start seeing they look a little yellow, not getting enough nutrients, then I'll start my regimen of having the fertilizer every other week. Now, with these plants growing into cells, you got to remember, you may have to water these things more than once a week. So be careful, because you can add too many nutrients. If you're seeing the edges of your leaves starting to yellow, turn brown, or you see some purple in your leaves, you know, back off. Go straight water for a few times, because those nutrients are going to hold in that soil for a while. And that's why I prefer peat moss over like coco coir. Coco coir doesn't hold the nutrients. It just doesn't. I've tried to use it before. It doesn't work well. Will it grow plants? Yeah, some will be okay with it, and some just will not like it. I know the peat moss mixture that I've been using works. I know it works better than the coco coir, so I stick with it. So what I'll be doing now is going over and getting my nutrient solution made. You don't really need to see that. It's just going to be a half a teaspoon of nutrients to a gallon of water and a half a teaspoon of pH down. I put the water in, shake it in an old bleach jug, and then that's what I'll use. And I also use room temperature water. Maybe not just a little bit warmer on the warmer side, actually, just because the basement's a little bit cool. And then I'll see you when I start to mix the solution, the water solution, with the soil. Here we are with our potting soil mix. I'll try to bring this a little closer so you can see. dry. See the perlite and the peat moss in there? The one thing I'll do is if there's big pieces of wood in there, I'll remove them. If there's matted pieces of peat moss, I'll just break them up. And I'm wearing this mask because when it's dry, it's dusty. Remember, that's nutrient water. And then I cut it in. I keep mixing it, and I'll pour more in until it's the right consistency. And the right consistency is when I can take some and squeeze it, and it doesn't drip down, but yet when you squeeze it like this, back and forth, it'll make a squishing noise. Then you know you got it right. Now I'm not going to have you sit through watching me do this for 5 minutes, so I'll be back with you when it's just right. Our potting soil is all dampened, mixed up well, looks wonderful. Now, the reason why you want to get this wet before you stick it in the cells is if we were to put that dry material in here, one, it's not going to firm down correctly, and two, you're going to have to water it after the seeds are in. If you water from the top when the seeds are in, it's going to push the seeds around, could even push them down near the bottom. So it's not a good idea. And you won't know exactly how full to put these cells when it's dry, because when it's wet, it's going to be a different level. Now, you could say, well, I could fill this up with the dry soil and then stick it in a tray and bottom water it. Well, then this material is going to, you know, if it was dry, the material is going to get too wet and you could rot your seeds. Or it's going to pool at the bottom, and some people just pour the water at the bottom and just leave it there, and it's just sitting in water, and that's not good either. So you get your soil to the consistency you need it, and then you put it in your cells. So what I'm going to do now is to kind of show you how I test it. Take a handful of this. Kind of put it in a little ball like that and squeeze. I can feel the moisture around cracks in my finger, and you can see there, it's there, but it's not dripping out. And if you were to squish it, I'm going to bring it near the microphone, I'm going to squish it and let up, squish it and let up, and it should go squish, squish, squish. That tells you got it. It's not You're seeing some stuff fall down there, that's the soil. But it's not dripping out, but yet you have that noise. And that's when you know you got it right. So next thing I'm going to do is to start filling cells. Now obviously I'm not going to show you how to do over 100 cells, because you wouldn't last that long on the video. So I'm going to do one for you. I just kind of move it around, stick my finger in there, push it down, and then kind of put more on top, kind of push it down, smooth it out, and then I use a special tool. It's called a piece of wood. I cut this out, put a couple edges on it, just took a knife and hacked off the edges. So it's the size of the top of the cell. And I just kind of firm that in like that. Just push it in just a little bit. Normally I'd have this on the table, and it'll just quickly go like that. And what that does for you, let's see if you can see this. It's got just a little bit of a lip here, so it's not even with the top. I don't like to go even with the top because then the roots kind of move over to the other cells. That's it. And I know that I have the right tension in that soil. And why is that important? Well, if you don't have this packed correctly and it's very loose, when the seed starts to grow, the root goes down, and then the regular stem starts to come up. And a lot of times, at the end of that stem where the leaves are going to come out, the shell will stay there. If you get the right tension, it tends to hold that seed shell down, and then the stem will hump up and then pull itself out of the shell. If it's too loose, the shell comes out. Now, that's not a disaster. Eventually, those leaves will pop out of that shell. But whenever you can do things the right way, you try to do it the right way. Now, even when I have the right tension on here, and another thing, too, is you got to have the right depth, because even if you have the right tension on here, it's tamped down just right, if you plant the seed too shallow, it's just going to push itself right out. Sometimes the roots will just push the root out and the stem and the seed. I have that happen a lot with onion seeds because I plant close to 1,000 onion seeds, and you're not going to get everything perfect. So make sure you plant them at the right depth, and it'll pop out of that shell. And if it doesn't, you know, don't freak out. It'll probably be okay. But if you can, try to do things the right way. And if it doesn't work out, oh well, there's always another day. You can replant more. So that's how I pack my cells with the soil. So now I'll be back to you again when I'm ready to start putting in some seeds. And what I'll probably do is just one little square, one little pack with the tomato seeds because they're easy to see. And so I'll see you then. Okay, we're back. We have all the cells filled. So now we're ready to do our planting. But before we go any further, I want to show you what I use to mark my packets here. I made these out of a bleach bottle. You just kind of cut the bottom and the top off, then cut straight up, and then cut these into strips. Then you can use a permanent marker and mark what these things are. The reason why I use these is these will last literally forever. They'll hold bleach. They're going to last a long time. They're flexible. I have literally tilled these into the ground and found them the next spring, pulled them back out and used them again. So I'll write down what the seed is, and I'll just slide it right in the edge of a cell. And the reason why I had these glasses on is I'm going to show you why I don't use the ones you get at the store. A lot of these are very brittle, and they won't last. So if you take and bend these things, they snap in two. I could take one of these things and twist it, and bend it any which way I want, run it through a rototiller, and I'll still be able to use it. These things don't last. All right? So now I want to show you how I pack my seeds. I use old printout paper where the back side is blank and I don't need what's on the front anymore. I'll cut it up into four pieces, fold it, use some tape, and I make my own seed packets. The reason why I put them in paper is so they'll hold the seed dry. Then what I'll do is I'll put it in a Ziploc bag, because I don't want more moisture going in there from the outside. I just push the air out and zip it up. And I'll put this in a refrigerator. Reason why I put it in the refrigerator is you want consistent cool temperatures. You don't want hot, you don't want hot, cold, and hot, cold. And I would put that in on the shelf on the door. You don't want it back by where it might possibly freeze. Every refrigerator seems to have a spot that tends to freeze. You don't want to do that. If your basement stays cool and consistent temperature, store it in your basement. It's just as good as a refrigerator. It doesn't have to be refrigerated. You don't want to freeze them. Some seeds can't take being frozen. So that's how I store the seeds, and then I bring them out, and we'll plant them. So what we're going to do now is to plant some tomato seeds. Actually, I put those over here. And I'm going to get my glasses on just to make sure I'm planting the right thing. I try to put as much information on this packet as I can. Here it says tomato long dense Roma 2020 for 2021. Use more of these. When I go out to collect seeds, I'm not just going out and plucking some tomatoes and bringing them in and taking the seeds out. What I'm doing is I'm looking at the plant. Is the plant vigorous? And if it's a tomato, does it have a lot of tomatoes? If it only just has one or two tomatoes, what's the point of saving seeds from that? You're trying to keep improving your genetics every year, or at least keeping them intact. And then if I see this tomato plant is a nice size, very healthy, vigorous, I'll take a tomato and I'll look, see if they're all, you know, ripening pretty much the same way on that plant. And they'll look the same. I'll take it in and I'll set it into a bowl all by itself. And then I'll let it sit there and age until it starts to, you can see it's starting to go bad. What people say it's going bad for eating. It starts to partially rot and wrinkle. Then what I'll do is once it's aged well enough, I'll open it up and I'll cut it and see if it's a meaty tomato. Actually, sometimes what I'll even do is I'll pick two tomatoes on the same plant next to each other that look the same. And when I bring them in the house, I'll cut one to see how dense it is. For my tomatoes, I don't like to see a lot of goo. I also don't like to see a lot of seeds, because if you get a lot of seeds, you're going to get a lot of goo. I like to see a lot of meat, because most of our tomatoes goes into making tomato sauce. But at the same time, they also taste wonderful. Even though they may look like a paste tomato, I've bred these tomatoes so they taste wonderful, no matter what you do with them. And that's another thing about saving your seeds, is you get to make the plant that you want. I mean, you go to these seed catalogs, and man, there's a plethora of tomatoes, and you say, boy, which one do I pick? Well, you can pick a bunch of them and then just kind of breed them together and come up with something that you really like, and that's what I've done. I've been working for years at this to come up with a tomato that's as perfect as it could be for my use. So you can call it a house tomato. So now, better get my glasses on so I can see what I'm doing. Just kind of dump some of these out. Now, I don't know if you'll be able to see this. I'll put a couple in my hand. Now let's see if you can see this. These are tomato seeds. And they might not look like tomato seeds to you because they look kind of fuzzy and tan. There's a reason for that. When you age your tomato seeds, the seed will mature and it gets a protective shell on it that's a lot more durable than the ones you'll buy mail order or at the store. So that's another reason why you should save your own tomato seeds. Is these things will be a lot better. They'll germinate better. Everything about them is better because they've been fully matured. So that's why my tomato seeds are not going to look like yours, unless you do the same thing as I do. Now, for each cell, I'll put 3 to 4 in. And I'll cherry pick these seeds, which means I'm only going to select the ones that look really good. And this, I'll probably just stick with 3. And I'll put them apart. I'll just stick them in there so they look apart. I'm only going to do these. Well, I better do the whole tray because I could lose track and not plant them all. Because once I shut the camera off, I got to do the rest of them. And if I bury them, and there's only certain cells that I've done this to, then I may not know where I was. This won't take long. And be careful when you plant tomato seeds that you don't get too stuck together, because then you're going to have to try to break them apart. And we're almost done. So we've got all our tomato seeds in there. So now I've got to get them in the soil. And I appear to have lost my special tool. Hang on. There it is. That's a pencil. Folks, use what you got. You don't need to go out and buy all these fancy tools and what have you. I mean, if you got the money, you know, then go out, spend money, and add to the economy. It's a good thing. But I try to make do with what I got. Sometimes what I got is actually better than stuff you can buy. But I'll use this pencil, and I'll just poke a little hole next to the seed. Then I'll push the seed in. Then I'll use the pencil to bury it. Poke a hole, push the seed in, bury it. And repeat till you're done. Now, once you get all three of them in there, take your finger and tamp it down. That's going to help for when it's germinating to hold that seed shell in there. So when it pops up, the shell stays in. But again, as I said before, the seed shell comes out, don't worry about it. It'll push out and around. And if it really bothers you, after the second leaves are starting to grow, just kind of nip it off. But you'll be fine. So now what I've got to do, is once I shut the camera off, is I got to go through and refresh the labels on my little tabs. And finish planting the rest of these seeds. Now, after the seeds are planted, I'll be putting them on top of a heat mat and then putting a dome over the top. And I'll show you that when I'm done. So for now, I got a lot of seeds to plant. So I'm going to crank up the music and get going. All right, we have the seeds planted. This is the way they're going to live for a few days. There's a heat mat. You got the seed trays, and then you have the top covers. This is what they look like without the top covers. Those are my hot peppers. I planted a week or two ago. Coming up so-so. I had to steal a heat mat from them, which wasn't a good idea. And they're in the basement, which is a little cool. They should be in another location. Should have had the heat mat on them for a couple weeks. But limited resources. Now, also want to show you a little trick here for picking up seeds when you're planting. Because sometimes those little seeds, very difficult to pick out of there. So you take a toothpick, special tool, dip it in a little bit of water, shake it off, find your seed, just touch it. And there you have it. Sticks on there like a magnet. Then you can plant it in your soil. Neat little trick. So I'll be tucking these away. And my garden's growing. That's it. Got doing the cell division jig. I hope you enjoyed the seed starting project. This is actually the beginning of the large gardens. I just kind of go over a list of the plants, the seeds that I put in tonight. I have a petunia. It's a special petunia that I created many years ago. It's a hot pink and white where the flower is kind of variegated. Also got some Dante peppers, green basil, red Thai basil. Now those two have been kind of intercrossed a little bit, so they're not 100% what they used to be, but I do kind of keep them a little bit segregated. I can tell when they're growing. If they get a little reddish, I'll plant those next to the reddish. If they're a little green, I'll put them near the green. Broccoli, again, that's my own seed. It started life as Arcadia. Brunswick cabbage and three lettuces. Again, they're all my own. There's a red, a dark green, and a light green. Then my tomatoes, which are kind of like giant Romas on steroids, white kale, salad burnet, eggplant, my seeds again, started life as black beauties, marigolds, they started life as Mr. Majestics, arugula, again my seed, started life as Astro, tomatilla, that I bought at a farmer's market last year, saved the seeds. It was kind of a purplish tomatillo. We'll see what happens. Tree basil, those are my seeds from last year's plant. I planted it next to red and green basil. I have no idea if they're gonna cross. They're kind of different plants, but I did get a lot of seeds. Don't know if they're viable. I planted them this year. Last year, when I bought the seeds online, only one germinated. I think a lot of other people had problems with these germinating. So who knows what will happen with these. And we have parsley. And a week or two ago, I planted my own hot red peppers that I created over many generations between three different pepper plants. And also planted some poblanos that I took the seeds from, that I got from a farmer's market. They didn't germinate well. They may not have been mature enough when they harvested them for seeds, even though I let them age. I did get one to grow. So what I'll be doing is a project where I take and segregate my red hot peppers in one garden, keep them separate, and then far away near the corner of the yard in another garden, I'm gonna interplant the Dantes, the poblanos, and my own red hot peppers to get them to cross. Because what I'm looking for is a hot, larger pepper, which is good in salsas, where you could also put it in spaghettis, Italian sauces, where you cut up like kind of a bell pepper, and it will kind of hold its shape. My red hot peppers are very good. They're about this long, and they all ripen red in the Northeast. It's a cross between a Serrano, a Thai, and somebody had a special little red pepper I got a seed from a friend of a friend. Heard I was looking for hot peppers. This was many years ago. And I crossed them all to get that one pepper plant that I have now, and it's very, very stable, very productive. Like I say, it ripens red. The whole bush will ripen red. And the bush is only medium in size, so it doesn't get too tall and it's not too short. Very vigorous, good plant. So I'm hoping to bring some of those properties into a larger pepper. Hence the Dantes and the Poblanos. So I hope you enjoyed this episode. And if you did, click the like button. If you haven't subscribed to my channel already, click subscribe. And if you want to be notified when there's other episodes coming out, click on a little bell. You'll be notified with your email. So I hope everybody gets out there and gets planting. Who knows what this year is going to be? But it's always good to have some plants growing and to eat your own vegetables. Take care. Be well.